Welcome as my Match of My Life guest today, a man whose brand new book is just out and it's called Blue Nose. That will give you an idea of his persuasion. He featured in the early part of the 70s and he's got many stories to tell about many famous names. It's Ronny Goodlass. Hello, Ronny.
Hi, Steve. Nice to see you. Nice.
Great to see you in the studio. So, Blue Nose, the idea behind the book, when did you think, right, I'd like to chronicle my Everton journey?
Well, I've been for many years, obviously, you know, you do after dinner, you bump into people and all that. And there was a function in town where, ironically, Ian Callaghan and Ray Stubbs were there. And Alan Ball was there. I got a couple of things signed. And it was ex-Barcelona players and ex-Everton players where we went into town, obviously. There's a good link with the two clubs and, you know, great night. You know what it's like, you have a few shandy and you carry on another few shandy and then a few stories. And virtually simultaneously, Cali and Stubbsy just turned and said, you've got to write a book. And it was always in my head. And I just think it was the right time. Now, you know, the way football's going, I mean, maybe financial-wise, it's going through the roof and telephone numbers for wages and the standard, and that's per week, that's not year. And you sort of think, well, let's put it down. And it's from, obviously, Blue Nose, that's why I've called it, because obviously an Everton fan, all the family are, and, you know, you've grew up watching the club that you love, and then you sign as an apprentice, you end up cleaning Alan Ball's boots. I was the first to get a white pair of boots off Bowley. Then he ends up a friend later in life as your career goes on. And then you go full circle. I played abroad, I played in the Far East, obviously at Tranmere Rovers, which obviously you know about. I was under Brian Hamilton, but the Johnny King, obviously he played at Everton, you know, iconic person, great football man, lovely, you know, gentleman as well, actually. But, you've got stories. Mark Palios has put something in for me and the likes of John Williams and Brian Hamilton. So it's football stories, but it's the way, I'm not saying the way it used to be, it used to be good in the old days, but, you know, being a local kid, you know, coming through, you support the club and then you're up playing for them. And then I ended up going back, obviously, as youth coach under Joe Rowe, where we got Danny Cadamatini, Michael Ball, Richard Dunn, you know, through to the first team. And then, obviously, doing the radio, which is fantastic. Mm. I mean, coaching's the next best thing to playing, but I think it's not far behind it when you can watch your club every week and comment on it.
And talk about it.
Well, it's lovely. And again, you keep it in touch with people and, you know, you're not just, commenting on things. You can see things happening and what's going on. I still get a buzz, you know, watching, you know, to today and even like last week here. Not the best of games against Huddersfield, but you still, you know, love it. I mean, we've done the hospitality lounges and the fan zones and, you know, you've got kids there who've never seen Alan Ball. They've heard of him, obviously, but then the Brian LeBones and the Howard Kendalls and the Gordon Wests, and there's different chapters that I do. I mean, they were sort of, you know, I say to kids now, you know, pick an iconic person as a player, but, you know, someone who's, you know, like a role model to you. And obviously I had a couple there, you know, obviously Labby was absolutely different class as a captain, as a person, encouraged you, you know, asked you about things. I mean, not just doing the boots, I used to do the first team kits as well. So you hear the little stories and the matches that he've played. And then, obviously, with Ball, he was, you know, there's a lot of stories about Ball in there, but it's just different things about, you know, that's why I've said my football story from every angle. You know, been a supporter, played, been a youth coach, and obviously now, you know, doing
I'm
the
talking
radio.
About it on the radio. Was there no other choice for you as a youngster than to be an Evertonian?
Oh, it's the family, Steve. I mean, we always say about, you know, Bowley said, you know, I know Neil Status Nisi Optimum's the, you know, the thing we go by. But Bowley said, you know, once Everton's touch you, it's never the same again. And it is. I mean, it's something through the family. You're born into being an Evertonian, you know, born, not manufactured, and it carries on. And as I say, it's a tradition.
Well, it was Dad, was it?
Well, it's
Granddad?
No, even further back, Steve. It was great-granddad, then granddad, then dad, then me, and then my four kids, all blue noses, and then you've got the grandkids. So it's carried on.
And it's the only acceptable thing, is it? In the Goodlass house, it was...
It can't be mixed marriages, Steve. It's,
even to that extent.
There is. I mean, I've got Liverpool there. You know, relations as well. But I mean, obviously with family, but it's the banter. I mean, I love the banter down the years. I mean, they were as proud when I made my debut as I was and family. You know, this is Liverpool, who are known friends. But they understand. I mean, I can sort of understand, obviously, and I know Jamie Carragher, you know, fairly well. I see Jamie often, and then obviously you're Steve Gerrard. I mean, if you support Liverpool, you know, they've got just as much passion as we have. But the whole point about it is that's your club. And this is why, you know, fans get frustrated. Obviously, Everton now, Liverpool, but Liverpool are doing slightly better than us. You know, both unbeaten. But, you can understand about it. And it's a football because, well, obviously, it's Blue Nose and you know, a lot of stories about Everton, obviously. But I keep saying about the way football's gone. You know, you'll get less and less books like this because, you know, players have virtually played a game in the car with their agents and they're gone. And next match you'll see, you know, you don't see them out sort of drinking. I'm not saying that, you know, you've got to go out and drink, but you'd bump into someone eating or wherever, and supporters would have a story. I bet you the older generation will have hundreds and hundreds of stories of different people who've bumped into or what's happened. But it's going less and less. And I think, I'm not saying sort of the corporate side, it's getting took away. That's the way football's gone and everyone needs finances to compete at the highest level. You've got to do it. But I just think, just to remind people now and again, especially Everton, you know, we one of the best teams, I think, that played in British football in 1969-70, which was my era, you know, the first year I joined the club.
Some brilliant stories behind this. Blue Nose, I'm talking with Ronny Goodlass about his brand new book, On the Terraces, in the Dressing Room, on the Radio as well, his football story from every angle. Growing up in Everton, were you focused on a career in football? Were you pressurized into a career in football by the family?
Well, I think again, Steve, it's you know, there's not many, especially from that area, who didn't want to be a footballer. I mean it's the big thing. You know we say about now with PlayStations and this, that and the other, what they do, and iPhones, you can do anything on them. And it ends up where, obviously, playing football at school, as soon as you come home, we used to, you know, sort of play at Grant Gardens, which is, you know, where we lived off Everton Road, and then SFX, we used to, you know, well, bunk over the wall, and then play in there. And it was just, you know, as you said, focused. They ended up going to John Hampton High School, so I'm not a thick footballer. But but it ends up where your focus, as you've said, is being a footballer. And that's the thing. Sometimes education goes out the window. I'd always advise everyone to, you know, education's everything, is to do that. But, you know, do it to the best of your ability. But football-wise, as I say, it was a thing where you couldn't think of anything else. You know, no, that was the, you know, the aim from when you first sort of got up in the morning to kick a ball around, and then you know, you can progress, which you did, you know, to Liverpool Schoolboys, and then that's when people then can start seeing you, the scouts, which is a good story in there, about Shanks and Paisley. They came to our house and wanted to sign me. You know, I got to.
So you were playing where at the time? Liverpool Schoolboys?
I was playing for Liverpool Schoolboys, played for when I was 14, and then when I played for 15, we won the English Schools Trophy. Yeah. Ironically,
what position were you in? You were
left wing,
right?
And then won the English Schools Trophy, and then obviously, you know, progressed to international then. So I scored 2 goals at Wembley, and then the scouts started knocking.
Yeah, so you're feeling quite good about yourself. You know, there's a bit of a tension on you.
Well, it's something again. You think, you know, you're getting recognised. You know, I've been picked for the school team. I've been picked for the Liverpool Schoolboys. I'm picked for England Schoolboys now. Hang on, you know, it could be happening. So when you're 14, 15, obviously the apprenticeships get, you know, dished out and whatever. And then when the clubs are coming, you know, actually Bob Paisley and, you know, Shanks came to the house and I answered the front door.
Unawares?
Unawares, just knocked on the door, came in. Dad was in the back and I just said, there's two fellas at the door, want to see you.
But you knew who they were?
Oh, yeah. Bill Shankly and Bob Paisley. So anyway, Dad shows him into the front room, says, would you like a cup of tea, coffee? You know, anyway, gives them that.
So he was polite.
Sits down.
Well,
as you said, Steve, you know, Blue Nose through and through. Yeah. And then Shanks just said, we want to sign Ronnie. Said, we've watched him for a long time, and we think, you know, or we know we'll make him a better footballer. So that I'm
were you listening at the door, were you?
Oh, no, I was in the room. Yeah? I was in the room, and then Bob Paisley just went, yes, Ronnie, we've been watching a long time and we will make you a better player and you'd love playing for Liverpool Football Club. So I thought, this is fantastic. You know, Everton hadn't knocked on the door. So the next minute, you know, carried on talking for a bit and said, anyway, think it over, Ronnie, and think it over, Mr. Goodlass, and, you know, we'll get back to you in a couple of days. So as they walked out the room, you know, my dad showed them out and then my dad came back in and said, I said, Dad, that's unbelievable. That. You know, someone iconic as Bill Shankly and Bob Paisley coming to the house and want to sign me for Liverpool Football Club. So I'm sitting on the couch with my dad just gets up, walks over to the door, opens the door and says, well, son, it's up to you. But if you sign for them, I'll never be able to watch a football match again. So then shut the door and I'm sitting there by myself and I went, thanks for the advice, Dad. Cheers. And then, you know, I'll cut it to you up. But the next day, knock on the door. I mean, I must be walking past the door all the time. But anyway, I opened the door and a fella called Matt McPeak was there. And he says, Ronnie, can I see your dad? I'm a scout for Everton Football Club.
And that was just coincidence. They hadn't heard that Liverpool had knocked.
No, not at all. And then, you know, I was like Usain Bolt running into the back room to get my dad again. I said, there's a fella there, Matt McPeak, the scout for Everton. So my dad was up, came in, sat him down, said, you know, do you want a cup of tea, cup of coffee? Would you like any biscuits? Do you want like a, you know, cake?
Rolled out the blue carpet
blue
for
carpet,
him. Yeah.
Exactly. And, yeah. Then, and then sat down, and then Matt just said, you know, obviously we've watched Ronny, we you know, we'll sign for Everton Football Club. And in my head, I'm just thinking, give us the pen. And my dad had a talk to him anyway. And then at the end of it, he said, we'd like to sign him, you know, think it over and we'll call back. And then after that, you know, we said, do you want anything stronger? So obviously, like little celebration drink. And anyway, they had that. And I think Matt doddled out. But Matt McPeak used to have a trick where he had a 2 pence piece and he used to flick it, kick it, and his top pocket, he used to open his top pocket and he used to go in his top pocket. And every time, Steve, he'd done it. So as he walked out the door and goes, I said, Dad, that's unbelievable, that Everton won a sign. And I said, that's the scout. And he's just flicked that something into his top pocket. What are the coaches going to be like?
Brilliant. The school of tricks.
Exactly.
Ronny Goodlass, brilliant stuff. He's doing his Match of My Life today. His new book is called Blue Nose.
Match of My Life. Life stories and greatest games.
Radio City Talk.
Ronny Goodlass is the guest for Match of My Life today. A devout Evertonian through birth, forced on him by his parents and grandparents. The chance to play for Everton and put the shirt on. I know it's sprung to a lot of footballers and you can ask them to pick out a match, but they always say the moment that mattered the most was when they put the shirt on and walked out in that spiritual home for the first time. How did it come about for you, Ronny?
Well, it is, Steve. I agree with that. I think what it is because you've supported the club for so long, and again, you know, there's different highs and lows, and then sign for the club. You know, to break through, you know, you've got to have something about you. And I think, again, about the dressing room, and, you know, you want to do the best, not just for yourself, but your family, your mates, and try and kick on. You know, you've got the opportunity where they may haven't, and can you do it? And then you go through the B team, the A team, reserves. I mean, we've got it where I mentioned in the book, we won the A-team league, and out of, you know, the 11 in the team, we all played for the first team from, you know, Gary Jones, Mick Lyons, Terry Dalicott, right the way through. You can name all of them. Mick Buckley, who played for England Schoolboys with, and I got Mick to sign for Everton. He was a mad Man United supporter, but he signed. But, you know, you look for it and then reserves, and then it was on the morning where I was obviously training with the first team, and you know, played sort of the training session, and Billy Bingham called me over and said, you know, how did you enjoy it today? And I said, you know, great, you know, really enjoyed it, and blah, blah, blah. He said, well, you might be enjoying it even better tonight, you're playing. And as soon as he says that, you think, say that again. So we went, you know, you're playing against Man United tonight. So on the way home, I mean, you're floating, but then you can't wait for the kickoff to come, and that's the big thing. But You know, when you sort of come up them steps and then you're in Z cars, and then the next minute you're out there and you just think, you know, this is what it's all about. And against Manchester United, obviously, you know, one of the big teams, shall we say. And then it was under floodlights. Just fantastic.
So it had all those mystical elements to it.
Just everything. I mean, I know it's cliched, Steve, but you know, it's absolutely massive because, again, you know, it's something that you dream about, you know, as a kid. And as you've said, you know, as soon as you start running around and you're playing with a football, you've got a blue shirt on and you want to play for the club. And it's years that it's building up. And, you know, not so much sort of pressure, but you're thinking, God, I want to make, my debut. And then when it comes around and it happens, it's you know, there's nothing better. I always think, you know, you can play in cup competitions or whatever, and, you know, great sorts of games. But that one against Manchester United, and they were going, if they'd have beat us that night, they'd have gone top of the league. So you're not playing, you know, against a poor team. You know, they're coming there full house at Goodison under floodlights and your debut. And it's, as I say, there's not many better feelings. And you know,
how do you play?
Well, funny enough, Steve, I hit the post and I had one kicked off the line. I did well and he hit one, believe it or not, from about 30 yards, which Alex Stepney was in goal. And I'm thinking, that's going in there. And it dipped. He just looked at it, and it missed by inches. And I thought to myself, you know, it wouldn't get much better scoring on your day. But as I say, hit the post. But one kicked off the line, drew 1-1. The latch scored, funny enough. And, you know, coming off at the end, you know, it's something where you could stay there and just look around the stadium and just think, you know, I've done
you
it.
You want that moment to and last forever, don't
exactly,
you?
Exactly, exactly.
So Billy Bingham, obviously an influence to you, but I think you've been lucky in that you've worked and met with a lot of Everton's biggest players. You mentioned Borley before. Yeah. So talk about him, first of all, and the relationship and the first time you actually came face-to-face with Alan Ball and, you know, in the company of greatness, really.
Well, as you said with Borley, massive. I met him, obviously, when we were doing the kit and doing the boots and, you know, he ended up getting the white pair in New York after him. But the thing with Borley, I mean, the standards that he set in training, you know, this is what, again, we tried to say when I was youth coach at Everton, you've got to do it as if it's a match situation. I mean, some people go out for training sessions, you just think, oh, what are we doing here? I can't wait for Saturday. You've got to, that's where you do it on the training ground, to get your fitness, to get, you know, if there's a left back, you know, your partnerships going, you know, getting crosses in early, you know, people understand things. And it's a big thing. But Borley, all the time, used to ask us, you know, how did I get on at the weekend? And I'm thinking, here's a fella 21 years of age, got man of the match in a World Cup final when someone scored a hat-trick. That's how good Borley was, not just in that game, but that's the way it was. And again, it's standards where, you know, at any club, you know, you can name me any club, their best player is you should achieve or try to achieve what he's doing. And that's the big thing over anybody. You know, you ask Joe Royal, you know, Colin Harvey, anyone, he's the best player, you know, as a teammate they've ever been in the team with. And it just raises everything. But what was fantastic about it, and you do get, you know, players of greatness are very humble. You know, Borley, again, he'd sort of do anything for you. Come in and talk about things. You're thinking, he wouldn't want to talk to me. And then he'd go on and say, do you see the game Saturday? And I'd go, yeah, I thought you played well. Yeah, well, I think we could have done better, though. We, you know, if we'd have got it wired a little bit earlier, to Johnny Morrison, and I'm just standing there thinking, you know, this is the start of my education, which it is. And that's why, again, with modern-day footballers, you know, you've got an academy separated from first team. Because we did the kit, besides me earwig and the stories from the weekend, you know, you're mixing with them. And then, again, it's an easier breakthrough when you finally get into the first team because you know them. And I just think, again, you know, doing the boots and all that, it grounds your state. It really does. I know now, and as I say, I wouldn't begrudge any footballer what they earn. Good luck to them if they can earn that money. But again, it's something where you've just got to keep your feet in the ground and say, you know, well, the next game, we've got to do it this way. We've got to go on. And when you've got that camaraderie in the dressing room and the togetherness, when you've got to dig in together, you know, you're all as one. But Borley's is the one I'd put up there with sort of anybody, as I say, for standards and, you know, raising the bar.
Only if
and
you could wear done. White boots. Only
well,
if you've
got to be a good
really.
Player, Steve, and especially at that time. I know there's pink and green and whatever colour now, and you know, all the colours of the rainbow you can wear now. But in them days, as you say, if you wore white boots, you've got to be outstanding. And that's what he was. But you can see, I've seen old footage. I mean, I've seen the game against in 1967, which any Evertonian or any football, you know, supporter, just watch it. It ended up when Manchester United won the European Cup the following year. So when we beat them, you know, Law Best and Charlton were in the team, Alex Stepney, whoever. And we beat them 3-1 at Goodison. And I'll never forget. It was absolutely fantastic. We've got it where Borley scored 2 and Alex Young scored 1. But it's the football we played 4-4. We played 4-3-3 that day, way, way before Barcelona did. You know, we played with the Holy Trinity, and then you've got, you know, two wide players, Jimmy Husband, Johnny Morrissey, and Joe Royal. And the football's fantastic. You know, full house, we beat them, you know, 3-1. And again, it's football, which hopefully we'll get back to that. And, you know, as a club, we haven't won silverware for a long time. So hopefully now with a new era, a new dawn, hopefully we can change it around. But, you know, I like to remind, you know, people all the time about, you know, the history and the heritage of Everton Football Club is fantastic. You know, it's up there with anybody. But the thing is, we've got to get back there again. You know, that's the thing. You know, we've had footballers like Alan Ball, you know, Ray Wilson, World Cup winner. And it's something that, you know, we've got to get back to. But great days. I mean, as you said...
The club deserves it. Yeah, look, I've not had a chance to read the whole book because you've just brought it in for me now, but I'm looking through the title of some of the different chapters. So I'll pick this one out here. Shock day when Pedigree Chum was on the Belfield menu. Is this a short story?
Well, it's it's a chapter of, we used to do court cases, Steve, and the court case used to be, Golden West was the judge and jury. So it'd end up,
well, so all the players acted out a courtroom scene.
Oh, yeah. Everyone, every first teamer, but you could be a reserve team player, an apprentice, whoever, and then the next minute they call you. And if you were seen signing an autograph by Belfield Gates and you hadn't even played in the first team, you could have been 16, 17 or whatever, we'd turn around and say, seen Steve Ollison yesterday signing autographs at the gate. So Westy would say, court case. So dress me in the dressing room. You'd have reserves, apprentices, and then the first team would come. And then Westy would come in with shorts on his head, as you know.
The judge.
But the pedigree chum one, it's a good story, so I'll let you read that one. But he came in. We had the court case, and it had to be, Fiery Jack. I don't know if you know Fiery Jack. Fiery Jack is the limit that you rub it. But you used to get it rubbed in a certain place that you didn't want it rubbed, and then go out to training. Next minute, it was 30 seconds before we went out, freezing cold plunge baths we used to have at Belfield. You'd get picked up with your kit on, lashed in the bath, and then you'd hear the coach shout, out for training. Next minute, you had no chance to get changed, so you had to go out soaking in like freezing cold weather. But the court cases is
so I've got the feeling if you found guilty, there's a major forfeit and pedigree chum might have been involved.
So, totally right. But it's very rare, Steve. You got off with it. Very, very rare.
Ronny Goodlass doing his Match of My Life. He's going to pick out his favourite game shortly.
Match of My Life. Life stories and greatest games.
Radio City Talk.
Ronny Goodlass is our guest. Match of My Life it is. Blue Nose is his. But there's so much we could talk about. We've got to condense things. We've spoken about some of the greats. Obviously, Alan Ball, one of those. Is there a definitive match for you? If you look through your career, do you feel you played enough for Everton?
Well, the thing is, if you read the book, Steve, they wanted to sign me back when I'd gone to Holland. And again, you know, breaking through at the time. And, you know, obviously there's good players there. But when I'd left, and I keep saying, you know, I mentioned it in the book, obviously, but it's something where once you get a taste of first team football, obviously you want to keep it going.
Yeah.
And again, with the manager, over the relationship, is the manager got an honesty with you? But it was the following season where Everton wanted to sign me back, which I don't think a lot of people will know. And
so what was the year you left? Was it 78?
70. It was just near the end of 77.
77. And you played 47 times at that point.
Well, yeah. And then we've done, two good cup competitions as well. We've done the competitions where we, you know, three League Cup finals, which was the longest cup final ever. And then obviously the semi-final when we played Liverpool and, you know, a certain Clive Thomas, you know, obviously, again, he gets a good mention in the book.
Just recount it for those who don't know the story very well, because it's obviously a very famous game, isn't it?
Well, we played Liverpool at Man City in the semi-final of the FA Cup. And, you know, Liverpool, you know, no two ways about it. You know, a few months after that, they won the European Cup. So they were half-decent side. Mm. But, you know, good side. But and again, we were in good form. And, you know, you're looking at Everton v Liverpool. You know, you couldn't get a ticket for love nor money. You know, they're hanging off the rafters, and then you come out and, you know, we played well that day. We really did, and we ended up 2-2, and then ball gets played out to me, and then took Tommy Smith on, get the cross in, and Brian Hamilton knocks it in with his hip. And, you know, I've sort of interviewed from Bruce Rioch, Duncan McKenzie, Brian Hamilton, Mike Pedgick, Ken McNaught, who are involved in the game, but also, you know, the controversial decision, and it is, you know, Smithy's told me, you know, Ray Clements, Jimmy Case, you know, Emlyn Hughes, we all knew it was a goal. But again, I won't spoil the story about the different things the players have said and what happens, but it's in the book. And as I've said about it...
But it's publicly known the referee didn't handle the situation very well, did he?
Honestly, absolutely awful. And Emlyn Hughes, actually, it was on telly not long after, and said he was on holiday with... you know, abroad anyway, seeing Clive Thomas. And Clive Thomas actually said to him, Emlyn, I think I made a rick there. And a little bit of French, he went, yeah, blah, blah. He went, you did, Clive, and just laughed his head off. So they knew, you know what I mean? But I say, I don't blame Liverpool players. You know, at the end of the day, it's that fella in black with the whistle. And the thing with him, he had a bigger ego, honestly, than Clattenburg, Graham Poll, all put together. And he was the you know, I am the man. And the more you, as I say, you look at it, you know that you've, you know, you got robbed of a cup final appearance, and that's the thing. And when you look down, in that you know, in our day, especially the cup competitions, where everything now with Champions League or different things, maybe it's not took the way it should be, you know, either weaken teams or do squad players or whatever until later rounds. You know, in that day, you wanted to win it, and it's massive. And then you might get a chance again, and that's, you know, that's another thing. But
still a little bit sore on it. Go on, let's get to your definitive game then. What stands out in wearing the blue shirt?
Yeah, well, I think the debut. I think that's when I say to be honest. I mean, I ended up playing in Holland and scored a winner against Ajax and Feyenoord and PSV Eindhoven, but. You know, the team that you love, that's they're the occasion. And, you know, we won at Manchester United 3-0 away in the quarterfinal at one of the cups. And, you know, great memories. But that first one is everything. I just think, you know, because, you know, you want to play that badly and you want to make the debut. And as I said, not just for yourself, but for family and friends. And you run out into the pitch. You know, it's something that you'll never, ever forget. And, you know, I think for anyone, I'd love even for yourself... To have that moment, and we're lucky enough, and other, you know, hundreds of footballers have done it, you know, not hundreds of thousands, you know, it's hard. And I keep saying now, over even getting a trial at clubs, it's hard to break through. But once you break through and make your debut, I think everything, all the Christmases come at once, and I think it's a great feeling, and you know, wish, you know, everyone could have that.
It's a very select band, isn't it, who have that opportunity to have that opportunity to feel the moment, be involved, especially at a club like Everton, wear that shirt, and it must have been unbelievable. Was it tough to leave?
Really tough. I've said again in the book about it. It's sort of something where you've got to say to yourself, you know, is this the time to go and all that? And as I say, I mentioned about Gordon Lee about it, where he wanted to play with two wingers, and then obviously he never. And, you know, that got me back up slightly. Mm. But the double whammy was, as I say, 6 months after Everton wanted to sign me back. And, you know, that was one of the worst feelings as well, you know, coming back to your beloved Everton. You know, it never happened. It was a big, you know, sort of minus for me. But as I say, you know, it's a club dear to my heart, obviously. And, you know, I ended up going back as youth team coach and all that. And you watch them week in and week out. But, you know, there's not many better feelings than making your debut for a club that you've watched all your life and dreamt of playing for.
Right, what does this remind you of then?
Well, the OJs around that time, we had some songs, Steve. I mean, I liked Elton John, and we watched Tavares at the Empire and watched Elton John. But the OJs was around about when, obviously, I made my debut. And, you know, it always reminds me of the club.
Of the football, does it?
Of the football, yeah. It's a good song. I mean, it's if you played this at a wedding, you'd get up, wouldn't you?
Was there music in the dressing room? Or would that be unheard of? Or?
No, you wouldn't have it then. But we used to go to a lot of concerts. I mean, we've been, as I say, you know, Elton John and you know, the Tavares one there at the Empire. But music, you know, Motown. I love the Beatles as well. But I mean, I think around that time it was a lot of Motown, which was good. And you know, we enjoyed it. I mean, I know now is what you mean is about the songs going on in the dressing room and all that. But it's funny because. Certain players like to be a little bit calm, sit in the corner, others will talk all day. You know, Duncan McKenzie went in our day, but I thought I could talk.
You couldn't shut him up, could you?
Well, exactly. you know, he used to go on about, but then you get others sitting in the corner. You know, Andy King, believe it or not, used to be a little bit quiet. You know, he'd rabbit a bit, but he was one where he used to get nerves, you know, before he went out. And then Mick Lyons would be, you know, either button the ceiling or button the wall. You know, that was his norm. But it's different things. But if someone with a big ghetto blaster, or you know, it's really banging the music out, I don't think it'll be for me. I'd like to do my own thing and concentrate on the football, to be honest.
Whether it be Bill Shankly, whether it be Alan Ball, whether it be The Goal That Never Was, it's a brilliant book, Blue Nose by Ronny Goodlass. You want to say thanks to Everton as well, because they hosted your book launch.
Yeah,
down at their new HQ.
Done the press launch last night, Steve. Absolutely fantastic. As I say, Everton Football Club, obviously, for me, class club. And last night, we were at the live. Absolutely fantastic. Looks the part. And we pushed the boat out. We had the press there and other broadcasters. And it's lovely. But as I said, I'd like to thank Everton Football Club. And I've got a dinner at Goodison tomorrow in the Alex Young suite, which... obviously, it's and my birthday as well, Steve. So we're gonna push the boat out a double one there. I think I'll go from Shandy's. I might force something a little bit stronger down me. But it's good. But as I say, with Everton, I just think they've done well by me, and I appreciate it.
Ronny Goodlass, friend of many years from the commentary box, and I wish you many more years of success. So thank you very much indeed. Have a look at his new book now, Blue Nose by Ronny Goodlass. And it's what, bookshops in the city, is it?
Well, it's going in Woodstores, but it's going in both Everton stores, you know, Everton 2 and then Everton 1 by the ground. And then obviously if you go on our website, www.healththroughsport, all one word, .co.uk/Blue Nose, you can purchase the book. I mean, people are doing it already, which you appreciate, as I say, and it's you know, you can get it online and it'll be whisked out to you, and you can have a read of it. Ronnie.